Good afternoon. My name is Leah Schweizer, and I'm with the Earth Science Data Systems GIS team. Today, we're going to be focusing on Hurricane Ida, which was a natural disaster event that occurred in August of 2021. Hurricane Ida was a deadly and destructive Category 4 Atlantic hurricane that became the second most damaging and intense hurricane to make landfall in the state of Louisiana. For today's demonstration, we'll be using ArcGIS Pro and NASA's Global Precipitation Measurement, or GPM IMERG, ArcGIS Image Service. This near real-time service estimates precipitation rate from multiple sensors and incorporates calibrations from climatological rain gauges. Data is available at 30-minute intervals and updated every 3 hours. This data spans from the year 2000 to near real-time and provides global coverage. We'll also leverage SEDAC's global man-made impervious surface data to understand the potential impact heavy rain events have on developed areas. So to get started, we'll first locate the service endpoint, which can be found by searching any of your public repositories for geospatial content, such as NASA's ArcGIS Online or Esri's Living Atlas in the World. By simply querying NASA precipitation, you'll see in the results a NASA authoritative source for the Global Precipitation Measurement IMERG Image Service. By clicking on the content item page, you'll be provided an overview of the data with a description about what is included in the service. You'll also find the input for the REST endpoint, which you can just copy the URL to then bring into your desktop software. Navigating ArcGIS Pro, we'll simply add data from path and copy that same URL, which will register as an ArcGIS image service and load it into the map. As I noted earlier, this is a global product, and so as the service renders, you'll see that it spans the entire globe, and that the time enablement will appear to show that the data spans from 2000 to near real time. Again, because we are focusing on Hurricane Ida, we're going to go ahead and zoom into our area of interest, which is the Gulf of Mexico, particularly the state of Louisiana. For this demonstration, we're also going to want to use raw data values. So we're actually going to remove the data processing, which was found in the data tab within the image service layer. These processing templates come preloaded with the image service. But for this purpose, we're going to opt out of the processing template, and this will establish a new value range of the raw data values from 0 to 250. Also, because we're looking at Hurricane Ida, we want to specify the time frame we're interested in, so the service only displays data from that particular event. Within the Data Properties tab, in the Time functionality, we're going to go ahead and identify our time frame of interest, which was late August 2021. The time tab will readjust once the data loads, and you can kind of start seeing a visual representation of the hurricane as it makes landfall. First, we'll want to use the raster function template to convert units. The GPM IMERG image service displays in millimeters per hour, and we're interested in using inches per hour because it is a more familiar measurement in this particular area. So under the analysis tab, you can deploy raster functions against the service. And the first thing, like I mentioned, we're going to convert units. So we'll input the service. We're going to go from millimeters to inches and create a new layer. This then converts the data values into inches per hour as a precipitation rate, which might be more easier to understand. This re-renders so you can very clearly see the hurricane coming into Louisiana. Now that we have the precipitation coverage over Louisiana, we want to extract values that experienced higher than normal values. In this case, we're going to look at values that are greater than or equal to half an inch per hour. For this, we're going to leverage the geoprocessing tool Extract by Attributes. We'll input the raster that we just converted, and we'll add a SQL statement to simply extract any values that are greater than or equal to a half an inch per hour. And our output raster will label as high precip. We'll go ahead. Now we can see the high precip value areas within the Louisiana area of interest. If interested, we can also change and use our own symbology to make it a little bit easier to see. So here we can adjust the change the symbology to, let's say, like the precipitation color scheme. We can also adjust the stretch type to minimum and maximum to see the values displayed. Now, as you can see, we're still working with a global service here. So there are values that are appearing outside of our geographic area of interest. So the next thing we want to do is apply another raster function to clip to our area of interest. In this case, we'll just use our current extent. So again, under the raster function template, we're going to go into the clip tool. And for here, the one thing I want to mention is that we want to make sure that our output pixel type is the same as the pixel type of the service itself. So it automatically defaults to unknown, but we're going to change that back to 32-bit unsigned to match the original source. And going back into the clip properties, we're going to just take all of those high precipitation values, and we're going to clip anything that's outside of this area of extent. This again will create a new layer that displays values. This is very difficult to see against a gray background, so again, if interested, we can change the symbology once again to precipitation, or really anything for that matter. This will show you the distinct values in our area of interest, and we no longer are leveraging the global service. Now, to make future steps a bit easier, we're going to convert this raster into a polygon so that we can employ selection tools in the future. So using the geoprocessing tool raster to polygon, we'll simply input this latest clipped high precipitation raster, and we'll create a new polygon. We'll name it high precip raster, and we're going to uncheck the simplify polygon so that we capture all the right boundaries of this raster. Now, while that's running, the one thing that we're going to do next is bring in other data that we're interested in. So one of the key benefits of using GIS is integrating multiple features and data sets together in order to visualize and analyze relationships, patterns, and impacts. So next, we're going to integrate the Socioeconomic Data and Application Centers, or SEDAC, Global Man-made Impervious Surface, or GMIS, data set from Landsat. This data will help us gauge potential runoff from the Gulf from severe rain events within this area of interest. So to navigate to the GMIS data, we'll go to the GMIS download portal. You can also obtain this data from NASA's Earth Data Search. But for here, since we're looking at a particular area of interest, we can select by downloading data by a polygon and simply draw a polygon to only look at data within our area of interest. Once we download that, we can identify what resolution we want, the projection system, and what layer we want. So again, we're going to be looking at just the GMIS data, which detects impervious surface percentages. This will then queue up the request, and I'll go ahead and cancel that because I do have that already pre-downloaded. And next, we'll bring that into our map. And this is a very GIS-ready, GIS-friendly data product that will easily load into ArcGIS Pro. So we'll bring in our geotiff data. And this will take a minute to load because it is pretty high resolution within this geographic area of interest. Again, it's detecting a percentage of all impervious surfaces from a range of 0 to 100. And as done previously, what we're going to do is focus on our specific area of interest. And so for this exercise, we're going to export the raster data, which will allow us to not only pull out the data values we're interested in, but also clip to our area of interest. So under data, export raster, again, we'll want to adjust our pixel values. check everything here. And also the no data value. So if you look at the README file of the GMIS dataset, you'll see that the no data values include the value 255. So we'll want to use that in this export so that we don't take any of those no data values with us. You can also adjust some additional parameters here, but we're going to leave those as is and just export to our area of interest. So we're essentially telling the software to only pull out any values that are within this raster to polygon converted area. This will then give us a much smaller subset of data to work with. So to hone in on the impervious surfaces and remove some of that background noise that you'll see in white, we're going to go ahead and adjust the symbology. So by changing the color and removing any non-impervious surface values, we can enhance our visualization. So you can see a lot of white there, and you also see that the values range from 0 to 200. But going back to the README, we'll note that the 200 are actually areas that are not covered in this particular data product, so we're really only looking at the 0 to 100% values. So we're going to go ahead and mask out any of the values that represent the 200, which are not included. And then for visualization purpose, maybe we'll just adjust the symbology so we can see the data a little bit easier. So this data represents the percentage of impervious surfaces detected ranging from 0 to 100%. Therefore, we're going to want to target areas with a high percentage or the majority impervious surface detected. So for this one, we're going to leverage a geoprocessing tool, the raster calculator. Raster calculator. And for this, we're going to want to pull out any values that are greater than or equal to 50 and less than or equal to 100. So that will give us, again, the majority of impervious surface values. So we'll say our variable is greater than or equal to 50 and less than or equal to 100. Once this creates our result, we'll now see these binary values based on just the location of the pixels that represent the majority of impervious surfaces. Next, we'll want to leverage this result to input zonal statistics and create a summary table, which will summarize the values of the rasters within the specific zone. So by using the zonal statistics as a table, we're going to input this new calculated impervious surface raster. And we're going to just create a zonal statistics table. And again, we're just interested in the summary, the values that are within this area of interest. This will summarize, again, all the pixels that do have a value that denotes it as a majority impervious surface. That table will load. And we can get a rough estimate for what values are considered impervious surface within our area of interest. And by doing a rough calculation, it looks like we're going to be looking at 2.5% of this area is heavily covered by impervious surfaces, thereby impacting the rainfall event. Another thing we can do is create a chart here and do a histogram to kind of just double check and denote whether or not these values are similar to the outputs that we just created with the zonal statistics. So this will just provide us a rough count of any of the surface values that have a high percentage of impervious surface. The count does match what was provided in the zonal statistics table. You can also go a few steps back to perform the same statistics across the entire spectrum, 0 to 100, and then export that and do your own calculations on whatever threshold you're interested in. So you could export this data into Excel and just run a similar query. But we now understand that the value of the estimated area of interest is roughly 2.5% heavily covered by impervious surface. So then downstream analysis could be applied to study the impact on the Gulf as the rain event moves inshore. Again, this was just a workflow to showcase most of the data, the tools, and the technology to help you understand ways to interact with NASA Earth observation data and services. And we, of course, will leave the ocean science up to you as the experts in the field. One other thing I also wanted to demonstrate within this particular use case is the ability to leverage web services. So another way to leverage NASA data within a GIS tool is for users that might be interested in exploring and just gaining awareness of data available. So this time we are using data services provided by the Global Imagery Browse Service, or GIBS data, which is the backbone for WorldView, which you might be familiar with. GIBS publishes time-enabled OGC web mapping services. And within your GIS tool of your choice, you can easily obtain the WMS needed and go through the same process of adding the data as a WMS into your map. You can do that by adding data from path or establishing a connection. So here I've already established a connection, and you'll see that I'm connected to GIBS, which will provide me with over 900 data products that you can easily input into your map that are time enabled for visualization. So just to give you a quick glimpse at what is provided here. And for this particular instance, we were pulling in some of the data related to sea surface. So as you can see here, I have loaded sea surface temperature as well as sea surface anomalies. As I mentioned, these are time enabled. So once you do look at the data, you'll see that the time enablement does show up. And then you can look at particular events of interest. So again, we can kind of see as this hurricane makes landfall, we're going to actually want to start on the same day. And we'll just look at one at a time here and see this update as it comes in. So this is just a level 3 product from a single satellite, so you can kind of see the gaps as they occur, but nevertheless you can see the changes as they come in. Something more of interest that might be something you all want to look at is the sea surface anomalies. So again, we'll go back and adjust our time frame. And this allows you to look at the anomalies detected as the hurricane comes in and makes landfall, goes onshore, and then produces this cooling event back in the Gulf. So these are just some examples of exploring data within a GIS tool and leveraging both the data and the services. This concludes the demonstration, and please let me know if you have any questions. Thank you.